The Heavy Cavalry Sword is one of the most famous but also maligned swords in history. So how good or how bad really was it? Hi, I'm Nick Thomas and welcome back to the Academy of Historical Fencing. And we're going to take a look at this sword, which is both loved, hated, loathed and respected in equal measures by so many different people. And I'm going to give you essentially an expert's opinion on it. And I'm also going to delve into basically voices of the past to understand what was thought about it in its time and place and by the people who actually used it. Because after all, I research, I collect and I use and I study these sorts of weapons and I teach their use. But ultimately, we are doing it as a fun hobby today. So I can give you that perspective, but we also need to delve back into history and understand it from the soldier's perspective, that we're actually on the battlefield and using these weapons in anger. So the 1796 Heavy Cavalry Sword. So this is a trooper's sword. There were officer's versions, which fundamentally are very similar, and we'll talk about that later in the video. I've got three antique examples that I'm going to be showing you on this video here today, and I'll talk about a whole range of different versions that existed of this type of sword. So the 1796 sword, Heavy Cavalry Trooper's Sword, came about because Gaspard Le Marchant, who was a cavalry officer, when he went to the Low Countries in the Netherlands in the 1790s, he found that there was a great deficiency in British swords and swordsmanship from a cavalry perspective. But he had a great respect for the Austrians, and he found that the Austrian swords and level of swordsmanship was excellent. So he came back to Britain and got working on both new types of sword design and also a new form of swordsmanship to improve both swords and swordsmanship in the British Army, and specifically the British Cavalry, because he was a cavalry officer. And he worked with the Birmingham swordmaker Osborne to develop a new kind of sabre. So Gaspard Le Marchant was a light cavalryman, which means he used a form of curved sabre, which was the form at the time. So he would have been using the 1788, so the first form of regulation cavalry sabre at the time in the British Army, and he really wasn't a fan of it. So this is the 1796. This is an officer's version of the 1796. So this is what came of Gaspard Le Marchant's new developments for the British Army. And basically what he ended up with was a slightly shorter sword than before that's also a lot more robust and can cut much more strongly. It's also, because it's a little bit shorter, it's a little bit more nimble, but it's not drastically different. It is a better sword in terms of durability and cutting power. That's certainly true. Anyway, that's what came about of it. And it seems that Gaspard Le Marchant wanted this sword to be adopted across all the different cavalry regiments of the British Army. So in the British Army at the time, you had two kinds of cavalry. You had light cavalry and you had heavy cavalry. And in some parts of history, you can also have medium cavalry as well. But as far as the British Army was concerned at this time, they had light cavalry and they had heavy cavalry. Now, that is important because they're intended to fulfill entirely different roles. So the light cavalryman was actually quite a new thing to the British Army in the 18th century. So typically, the British Army had dragoons, which were equipped with usually some kind of heavy straight sword like this. And they could sometimes be intended to fight on foot and sometimes on horseback and sometimes a mix of the two. By the Napoleonic period, the idea of the dragoon was mostly a mounted role, as before it could be a kind of a mix of the two. And in the mid 18th century, the first light cavalry regiments began to pop up with the British, and they eventually went to the curved, what we'd call hussar sabre. And the two different roles between the heavy cavalry, which would be called heavy dragoons, and light cavalry, light dragoons, is the heavy cavalry are essentially a blunt instrument. They're like the knights of old, if you like. So they are usually the biggest horses, the biggest men, and the biggest swords, and they're designed to be a blunt instrument to go in there and devastate entire sort of battalions, if you like, and regiments. And the light cavalryman is intended to mostly do things like scouting roles, go after artillery, and basically supporting roles. Now, in reality, on the battlefield, it didn't quite work that way. Often the light cavalrymen did end up in the big massed brawls as well, but that was the intent. And so the light cavalry ended up with this, which has very little hand protection compared to some of the swords of the time, but has ferocious cutting power. So in terms of the role it was intended for, it's excellent. It's not a great weapon to fight one-on-one with. and it'll work, but it's not great because it's not the most nimble and doesn't have a lot of hand protection. But in terms of scouting duties and harassing skirmishers and chasing down fleeing troops, attacking artillery, all that kind of thing, this is going to be monstrous, absolutely perfect for the job. And this is a really well-loved sword. Curiously, it's not necessarily as good as people would quite think because of the reasons I just mentioned. So yes, it has ferocious cutting power, but it doesn't have a massive amount of reach. It is not the most nimble thing in the world because it has a lot of weight going forward, and it doesn't have an awful lot of hand protection. So it's a very good striking, cutting sword, but in every other way, it's not amazing. So it's an amazing cutter. Now, the heavy dragoons, heavy cavalry, they were, as I said, designed more of a kind of knightly role, designed for a full-on sort of brawl. And their sword is, by regulation, 2 inches longer, which may not seem, it's actually 2 to 2.5, because this was 32.5 to 33 inch by regulation, this was 35. Doesn't necessarily sound like much, but anybody that's done much with swordsmanship will know that 2 to 2.5 inches is actually quite a lot. So 2 inches is 5 centimeters, so, you know, that or a little bit more. 5 centimeters is actually a lot in sword terms. So it's got a little bit of extra reach. It doesn't flare at the tip like the light cavalry one, so it doesn't add a lot of mass there. And it has a hell of a lot more hand protection. So what that means is you've got a sword that is, in actual fact, a little bit more nimble. And it's hard to believe because the heavy cavalry sword is thought of as a heavy, unwieldy beast. And everybody raves about the light cavalry as some nimble, amazing cutter. The reality is that there's not much difference between the weight of the two of them, and the heavy cavalry balances generally a bit closer to the hand, so it's actually a slightly more nimble weapon. So, you know, if I was actually to go into a brawl with any kind of swordsman, whether mounted or dismounted, I'd choose the heavy cavalry. It's got a bit more reach, it's a little bit more nimble, has a little bit more hand protection, and the only thing it sacrifices is it doesn't have quite such an amazing cut to it because there's not quite so much mass in the tip, and the curved blade does have some natural cutting strength to it. Is that a good curved blade has a natural draw to it and has natural edge alignment. But we'll talk about the cutting power with this a little bit later. As a result, you end up with these two swords, which are remembered curiously in modern times in a rather bizarre way, that this is the sort of really fast, light, agile sword that is amazing, and this is the really cumbersome, heavy one, which is can't really do anything and is a bit rubbish. Now, I've just told you from a handling perspective, that's not true. From a handling perspective, actually, the heavy cav is nothing like as cumbersome as people would say today. And in fact, the light cav is the one that's a little bit more lacking in agility or celerity, as they often talked about at the time. So that gives you a little bit of perspective on the two sort of cavalry swords that were in use at the time. Now, it's worth mentioning at this point that the troopers' swords are usually fairly close to one another in specification when you compare example to example. When you look at officers' versions, so I was just showing you an officer's version of the light cavalry saber, there's massive variety. So generally speaking, an officer's version of either of the 1796 cavalry swords is usually lighter, slightly nicer made, a little bit more agile, but not always. So that officer's sword I just showed you actually is just the same weight and handling specification of a trooper's sword. So they can vary, but generally speaking, the officer's ones are made a little bit lighter, a little bit better, and a little bit more agile. I'm for the most part going to be sticking to talking about trooper's swords in this video because ultimately you don't have that many officers to that many troopers, so people are going to want to hear about the sword that got the most usage. So, what came before this? Because that's also important. Because I said that Gaspar Le Marchant was not happy with the cavalry swords at the time, cavalry sabers especially, and he found that what they were using, well, for a start, lacked in consistency because there were so many different types in use. Technically, there were regulations for light and heavy cavalry, but he says barely one regiment had the same, so clearly there was a lot of variety. And he found that the swords were too long and too weak and too brittle and basically lacking in handling characteristics. And that's a curious one because when you get into the Napoleonic period, you'll find complaints that the British swords were too short. But curiously, Gaspard Le Marchant, who was key to bringing in these new patterns, absolutely wanted them to be shorter. Now, why would that be? Well, it actually comes down to a fundamental difference in how the swords were being used. So the French constantly encouraged the cavalrymen to thrust as much as humanly possible. They wanted them to use the point, or give point, as is often the term used at the time, rather than use the cut. Whereas the British cavalry were famous for constantly cutting. So it's actually described in account after account that no matter how much you train an Englishman or Irishman or Scotsman, Welshman, anyone, in the British Army, no matter how much you train them to use the point or to give point, when it comes to the actual combat, they start hacking and hacking and hacking. Now, that's kind of a half-truth, because if you read the accounts, you'll actually still find plenty of usage of the point. But it is true, without a doubt, that most of the time, the British cavalry were hacking, using the cut rather than the thrust. Whereas the French, who also used both, it wasn't a clean cut, one used one and one used the other. The French did use both, but they preferred the point. So when we talk about, is a sword too short or too long for the role, it's important to understand why it's being used and how it's been developed. So the French cuirassier swords, for example, were very long, a good bit longer than the British heavy cavalry sword, but it was designed more for thrusting. So it can cut, it absolutely can cut. It's not as good at cutting. There's not so much mass in the tip, and the edge geometry is not quite so good. It's not quite as good a cutting sword, but it is a better thruster. When I say better, it doesn't necessarily mean it does more damage, but it's a bit more agile and it has a bit more reach for thrust work. But remember, the British want to do lots of cutting. And if you want to do lots of cutting, a 39-inch bladed sword, you know, is a handful. So yes, they were a little bit shorter because they wanted to do a lot of cutting, and they wanted a agile but also robust cutting sword. So they're not too short. They were designed that way to do the job that they wanted to do. So they're not too short. And ultimately, a 35-inch blade is not that short anyway. So the cuirassier swords were unusually long. A 35-inch blade is very long for a cutting sword. So we talked about what came before the heavy cav, the 1796 heavy cav. Well, basically this. So I said that before this, there was a regulation, but it was loose, and different regiments had all kinds of different things. And this is one example. So this is a British dragoon sword from about 1780. Now, some of these had pretty much full basket hilts, and some of them had just a slot hilt like this, and this is a slot hilt with additional side branches. So there are various derivatives of this, but this is the kind of British cavalry dragoon sword that was in use in the kind of 1780s and early 1790s. And it's a little bit longer. I mean, they vary, they can be a good bit longer, but it's a little bit longer, a little bit thinner a blade, and you can see it's not going to be as durable, but it is a bit longer and not quite so agile, and this isn't one of the largest examples. So that's the kind of thing that Gaspard was not happy with, is that basically a very large sword that's a bit too cumbersome but also a bit too brittle, and a bit too weak. Now, let's go back to the heavy cav and actually look at its attributes. To understand what it's like as a sword, we need to look at all the individual aspects. We need to look at the guard, the grip, the blade, the handling characteristics, the flexibility, the mass distribution. We need to look at all these things to understand how good or bad a sword it is. So let's start down here. The grip. Now, there were lots of criticisms of British sword grips through different time periods, mostly that they turned in the hand. And you do end up with swords that turn in the hand, usually because a grip is too round or sometimes too square, depending on the time period. So for example, the 1853 trooper's sword has a kind of very square grip. That some square grips are quite good, but that one, it's kind of squared and then rounded on the corners. So it just does turn in the hand. And the problem with turning in the hand is you can end up hitting with the flat of the sword. And this was actually a problem well known during the Napoleonic period and either side of it, is that if a sword turned in the hand, it'll hit with the flat and give a light bruise, if anything. So it's absolutely useless. And it was a major concern at the time. A curved blade does naturally more align. As you swing it, the curvature basically brings the edge online rather well. But of course, this is a straight sword, and you can end up turning in the hand for lots of reasons. It can be because the grip is badly shaped, because there's too much mass on one side of the hilt, so it forces it to turn, because your grip is not very good, your training is not very good, because you didn't make a very good cut. all sorts of reasons, but you know, if it does turn in the hand, it's a real problem because you're just hitting somebody with a flexible, wide piece of steel, which is just going to annoy them. Now, the way this was usually overcome in the Napoleonic period was to have this basically bulge and this notch here. So the cavalry sword was often wielded like this. It's almost like it's a pistol grip down here. Now you could have the thumb up or you could have it on the side depending on the weight of the blade, and that's talked about in manuals at the time. But this basically curve here to the grip, this bulge, and this crook here, both assist in stopping the sword turning in the hand. Now, as I said, there are various ways that this can be achieved, but personally, I find this to be one very effective way to do it. So I actually like the grip on these. I think they're actually really, really nice. Is they provide good purchase and they don't turn in the hand. I like them. So let's get on to the guard. Now, swords of this period had a mixture of steel, brass, and copper guards, and a mix of different protections. So some just had simple stirrup hilts like the light cav I showed you there. The heavy cavalry sword was usually called a disc hilt for kind of obvious reasons. Now this one has actually been reduced on the inside. The heavy cavalry trooper sword of this type was a completely symmetrical hilt. So this inside of the guard would have been exactly the same as that. This has been cut away, which was a common modification. So this particular example has actually had a number of modifications. It's had the inner guard cut away, it's had the langets removed, and it's had the tip reprofiled. So this essentially has had a load of modifications to improve it and make a better sword. And this was usually done in the field. So in actual fact, this hilt shows you what the symmetrical dish would have looked like. Although this sword in itself has a modification of its own, which is the cutaway of the back of the guard or where the quillen section would be, which the other example here has. So it would have been symmetrical. It was cut away mostly for making it sit better on the uniform and not rub the uniform and stuff like that. But it still has enough protection to protect the thumb. So how is this in terms of protection? Well, actually it's really good. It compares favorably to most of the kind of heavy duty swords of the era. If you compare it to most cavalry swords that followed, it's not drastically different. If we look to the officer's version, which is sometimes called the ladder hilt, it's not hugely different. It's more kind of a bowl shape rather than this disc and knuckle bow. So it's basically a more elaborate version of the same kind of guard in terms of protection levels. So it doesn't offer as much protection as a basket hilt, but it offers as much as essentially a bowl hilt will, which is a lot, and was kind of a standard for cavalry swords later on. So the hand protection is excellent. The steel is really thick. It's going to stop a very heavy blow. And they also had a reinforcement plate fitted inside the guard, which is where you're going to take a lot of stress and a lot of blows. So that's reinforced heavily inside as well. So the guard, as much as some people think it's ugly, and I can understand that, it looks very industrial. And yeah, you could call it ugly, but this is a trooper's sword. It's not designed to look attractive. It's designed to functionally do a job, and it does that job very, very well. It's easy to manufacture, it gives good protection, and it's really strong. So can't really complain with that. And there are accounts of people, of cavalrymen using them to punch and strike with very effectively as well. So clearly they did the job there. Onto the blade. So the criticism of the 1796 heavy cavalry sword pretty much always comes down to the blade. It's said to be, by different sources, some say too short, some say too long, but the thing that a lot of modern sources especially agree on is that it is cumbersome, and they say that it can't thrust, and some even say that it doesn't cut very well. So let's look at that. Is it cumbersome? For a essentially a good broadsword, good backsword, not really. You know, these kind of straight cavalry swords were in use essentially from the early 17th century, and there's not a huge amount of difference between a lot of them. Some of them are double-edged and some of them are single-edged, but you know, it's not going to handle like a nimble infantry sword or fencing sword. It is a heavy dragoon sword, so it is what it is. Judge it by the standards of a broadsword and not a light saber, for example. I don't mean light cavalry saber, I mean a light saber. Not that kind of saber either. So is it cumbersome? Not really. It's actually in line with a lot of broadswords and what you'd call backswords. This is, of course, ultimately is a kind of backsword. No, the problem with people judging it by saying that it's lacking in agility, it's too slow, it's cumbersome, is because it's usually modern perspectives judging it out of context and against swords which it really shouldn't be compared to. So yeah, when you compare it to, say, an infantry saber of the 19th century, it's cumbersome and slow compared to that, but it's not an infantry sword. Now on to the thrust and the cut. Well, how well can it cut? It has good edge geometry, and it has a good bit of mass and a good bit of length. Of course it can cut well, and if you look at the primary sources, so forget any modern day tests, just look at the historical sources, there are account after account of it cutting very, very strongly. So, and we'll go back to that in a minute, let's just look at one last factor, and that is the thrust work. So I did say that the British cavalry weren't known for using much thrusting, and yet they did need to thrust. How good was it as a thrusting sword? Well, when it was initially produced, it had what we would call a hatchet tip. And a hatchet tip is not good for thrust work. So this sword is also a 1796 trooper's sword, even though it looks quite different. But you see the blade is much the same. It's a very similar overall sword, even though it looks quite different. So this is the Royal Horse Guards sword of the same period. And it's a bit of a monster, but the reason I'm going to show it to you right now is this has the original hatchet tip on it. And you can see why it's called a hatchet tip, because it looks like a hatchet. And unsurprisingly, if you give a sword a hatchet tip, it's kind of very blunt. Not entirely blunt, it could thrust, but it's really not a good thruster. So as the original regulation was, the British heavy cavalry swords, they had this hatchet tip, and it is rubbish. As a cutting sword, perfectly fine. A hatchet tip means that you've got a heavy, basically a blunt force instrument, sharpen it up, and you've got massive cutting power. So that cutting power on that horse guard sword is just devastating, but it massively compromises the thrust work. So what was happening in the Napoleonic period, and we know it happened by orders just before Waterloo, and quite possibly happened well before in certain regiments, is they reprofiled the tips of their swords. So this example I am holding here has a reprofiled tip, and you'll notice that this is going to thrust really, really well. No problems at all. And these swords were improved with various means. So just before Waterloo, it's described by, in one account, that the soldiers were ordered to grind the backs of their swords. And what that means is that the hatchet tip is straight all along the back, all the way to the tip, which is why you end up with a hatchet tip. If you grind the back in at the tip, then you grind it into a form of spear point. And that makes it a much better thrusting sword and more like the cavalry swords that followed it through the 19th century. It can take different forms of shape. You don't have to grind the back, so you can just give essentially a smoother taper into the point on the true edge. That will give a better point. And the sword that Sergeant Ewart used at Waterloo is of that type. You can also do that and grind the back in a little bit, which gives what this is, which is an improved asymmetric tip. Or you can grind the back edge into a central point that gives a symmetrical spear point. And some of those symmetrical spear point swords are also reduced down to 33 inch. So the regulation heavy cavalry sword was 35 inch. This is actually has only lost a tiny amount because it's been ground at the back. So 35 inches 89 centimeters. This has been reduced to 88 centimeters. It's lost 1 centimeter for having been reground into a really good point. And by giving this grind, it's also reduced a little bit of mass at the tip. So this still cuts really well, but it's a bit more agile than it used to be. Just a little bit, but taking mass out at the tip, obviously the furthest point from the hand, does make a difference. So when the heavy cavalry sword, the 796, first came out, it did have a rubbish tip. It was basically a blunt tip that you couldn't do much with. So from that perspective, it was not a good thrusting sword. But it got improved in the field, it even got improved by orders, and there's speculation that later on swords may have been even made that way from the factory. And certainly if you look at surviving examples, a massive amount of surviving examples of the heavy cavs have these reprofiled tips in the various different ways that I talked about. The last thing to say about with thrusting ability is, with a thrusting sword, you generally want it to be reasonably stiff. And actually, the heavy cavalry swords are quite flexible. In some recent comparative tests that I've done, I've actually found that the heavy cavs are often some of the most flexible swords that the British were using at that time. Saying that, it's still stiff enough, and the first-hand accounts show that it clearly was stiff enough because they were using it regularly to actually kill, so it clearly did the job. And the one advantage of having a very springy blade like this is it's going to be very durable. And of course, a heavy cavalryman, again, they're a blunt instrument. They're designed to get in there and hack and slash and really use brute force. So their blades need to be durable. So I think having this very, very flexible blade is actually going to do them a lot of good in terms of durability over time. So overall then, my perspective, what is it like? Well, the grip's good, the hand protection is good, even if it might find it a bit ugly on the trooper's swords. The blade characteristics are fine as a mostly cut-in sword, and if you reprofile the tip, it becomes really good as a thrusting sword. And ultimately, how good is a thrusting sword compared to, say, a cuirassier's sword? Well, it's still a, you know, close to 35-inch blade, and with a good point on it, it's only a little bit, you know, a few inches shorter than the cuirassier's swords. It's a lot more agile up close and has a better cut. So actually, from the perspective of a mostly cut-in sword for cavalry usage, it's actually pretty good. You know, it's a good solid broadsword or good solid backsword. There's nothing really wrong with it. It's generally criticized so heavily in modern sources. And that's important to consider when we then delve into some actual accounts of what happened at the time. So I can talk from as essentially a modern expert, if you like, perspective, because yeah, I deal a lot with these swords. I test cut with them, I research them, teach their use, fight with them, but not for real. But if we delve into some first-hand accounts, we can get a perspective on how it was judged at the time, which of course is in many ways much more important than anything I can say about it today, because I'm still judging it from 200 years into the future with people who don't use swords to actually kill each other with anymore. Hopefully not anyway. So this book, British Sword Fighting by Kinsley, this is essentially a book that's just a collection mostly of first-hand accounts of sword combat in mostly the 18th and 19th century. And I would highly recommend you buy this because for anybody, it doesn't matter what kind of sword fighting you're interested in, you will never find a book with as many accounts of actual sword combat firsthand as this, not even close. So if you want to have some idea of what sword fights were like for real, this book is the one you want to get. And obviously it's about British sword fighters, so it has obviously that slant, but it is just jam-packed with historical accounts. So I'm gonna delve into it a little bit here just to look at how the heavy cavalry sword was thought of at the time. Corporal John Shaw of the 2nd Life Guards, which were heavy cavalry, dashed in among these steel-plated invincibles, as Napoleon styled them, that's the French cuirassiers, which are armoured heavy cavalry, dragged them from their horses, hurled them to the ground, and then pierced them in their vulnerable part, the groin, with his sword. He thus slew them with his own weapon, at least 9 or 10. So, a few things to take away from that. One, this cavalryman took on 9 or 10 cuirassiers, one after the other, which a cuirassier were the elite French heavy cavalry. So they had their steel cuirass, their helmets, their big cuirassier sword. They were well-trained, well-equipped, and he went through them. So that's interesting. So already, how good is the heavy cavalry sword? Well, if it's able to kill 9 or 10 men, clearly it was up to the task. Two, he pierced them, thrust work. So for all that, you know, nonsense about the Brits never thrust, the Englishmen never thrust, well, clearly they did. There's actually accounts of thrusting with the heavy cavalry and the light cavalry sword. So this video is not about the light cavalry sword, but it is worth mentioning that so often people say that because this is a heavily curved sword with a hatchet tip, it can't thrust. And that's absolutely nonsense because curved swords all around the world have been used for thrusting, usually not as much as cutting, but they absolutely can thrust. And you'll notice that the hatchet tip on this is not as blunt as the horse guard sword that I showed you. So worth mentioning that absolutely thrusting was done with both the light and the heavy cavalry swords. So there you go. That is a good example. Another one would be Sir John Ellie, Colonel of the Blues, and Captain Horace Seymour, who was on his staff, two of the most powerful men in the army. They performed at Waterloo deeds worthy of the paladins of the olden time. Horse and man went down before them as they went onward in their headlong course, and neither helmet nor cuirass could stand against sword wielded by such strong arms. The Earl of Uxbridge, Wellington's chief of cavalry, who had abundant opportunities of witnessing Horace Seymour's feats of personal prowess, for he had been his aide-de-camp at Waterloo, declared that in the final pursuit at Waterloo, he saw him, in imitation of the French, whose swordsmanship he has often extolled, charge at point, and pink them out of the saddles. By sheer force of arm and length of sword, six or seven cuirassiers, one after the other. So another good example of the heavy cavalry sword absolutely doing its job. Now, that's an officer, so he should have had the officer's version of the heavy cavalry sword. But remember, it's much the same weapon. It has a slightly different aesthetic to the hilt, but it is still the same sword. In one charge, he saw Horace dash into the very centre of a dense body of cavalry, and by the weight of his horse, the length of his sword, and the strength of his arm, cleave his way through them. Favoured by the smoke in which he was enveloped, he turned his horse's head and resolved to sell his life dearly, charged through them from behind. A stream ran between them, the opposing forces, to which the troops on either side eagerly repaired for the purpose of slaking their rage and thirst, and those who had recently been engaged in deadly combat were good-humouredly chafing at each other. And when a gigantic soldier came out from the French ranks and challenged any man in the English to meet him in single combat, "Do you hear that, Horace?" said one of a group of cavalry officers who collected together. "Yes, I hear it," said he, with clenched teeth. In another second, he had leapt his horse across the brook, dashed in among the enemy, and in the sight of both armies, fought with and slain the boastful Goliath. Once again, the heavy cavalry sword doing its job perfectly well. In another account, Sergeant Thomas Morris, 73rd Regiment of Foot, regarding an incident at Waterloo. "I noticed one of the lifeguards, who was attacked by two cuirassiers at the same time. He bravely maintained the unequal conflict for a minute or two, when he disposed of one of them by a deadly thrust in the throat. His combat with the other one lasted about 5 minutes, when the guardsman struck his opponent a slashing backhanded stroke and sent his helmet some distance with the head inside it. The horse galloped away with the headless rider, sitting erect in the saddle, the blood spouting out of the arteries like so many fountains." So for any criticism of the cutting ability of the heavy cavalry sword, it is clearly shown in the first-hand accounts how it is savagely cutting the opponents down and actually taking heads off. Now, if a cutting sword is able to cleave a head clean from the body, then it is absolutely a good cutting sword. And here's another commentary now about the length of the sword, but also the ability of it. So, the English swords were under disadvantage of being 6 inches shorter than the French. On the other hand, the armour worn by the French proved no real defence against their assailants, who, if occasionally finding their swords rendered ineffective by the breastplates of the cuirassiers, took to cutting at the exposed parts of their persons. The vigorous blows of the lifeguards not seldom pierced their adversaries' armour, and in some instances clove their helmets right through. It is so observed that a wound through a cuirass mostly proves fatal. And an account goes on. "It was fearful to see the carnage that took place at Waterloo. The Dragoons, Royals, Greys, Blues and Inniskillens were lopping off heads at every stroke, while the French were calling for quarter." Now obviously, an accounts of this time from soldiers from these regiments, they're going to be surely overly glorified and ultimately written by the victors. So some of it you need to take with a pinch of salt, but ultimately there are so many first-hand accounts that talk about the heavy cavalry, because so much more was written about the cavalry sword usage, because ultimately the sword was the primary weapon to most cavalrymen, unlike, say, infantrymen. I often talk about infantry swords, but of course swords were not the main weapon of most infantries. And anyway, there's a lot written about the heavy cavalry sword, and you can clearly see that actually it was doing a frightful job. In one other account during Waterloo, one infantryman was noted as seeing a British heavy cavalryman fighting on foot. So, ultimately a cavalryman is intended to fight on horseback, but they had to fight on foot at times, usually because their horse has been shot out from under them, but there are other reasons in terms of terrain and things like that. But at Waterloo, if a cavalryman was fighting on foot, it was likely because his horse had been shot out or cut out or thrust out from under him. And this one particular account where an infantryman spots a British cavalryman fighting two cuirassiers on foot. So they're all on foot, fighting two cuirassiers on foot at the same time, and cleaves both of their heads off with a cut 5 and 6. So cut 5 and 6 are the two horizontal cuts. So this one is 5 and this one is 6. They're the two horizontal cuts of the British cutting system. And again, clearly that's an unequal fight. One against two, it's a tough fight, and devastated both. And another good example of the heavy cavalry usage would, or heavy cavalry sword usage, would be by Sergeant Ewart at the Battle of Waterloo once again. So Ewart is famous for taking a French eagle, which of course was a huge deal at the time. And to get this eagle, he had to fight through three Frenchmen to get it, including a lancer, a soldier with a bayonet, and the eagle bearer. And he parried off and hacked his way through them, taking off one's jaw, absolutely savaged them with only his heavy cavalry sword. And that sword is still preserved today and is exactly this type of sword I'm holding here. It's just the tip on his just has the front edge reprofiled rather than the back edge, which mine has as well. So that is a good amount about the heavy cavalry sword. I am also going to look at the Horse Guard sword, because this thing is a very rare beast. And I say beast because when people talk about the heavy cavalry sword being heavy and slow and cumbersome, it isn't, but this one is, okay? And my one especially. So if you look at the ones that are in, well, there aren't many around, but if you look at one example that's in the Royal Armouries collection, it's heavier than the most heavy cavalry swords, but not quite as heavy as mine. Mine is an especially heavy brute. 1.38 kilos with the same regulation length blade as a standard heavy cav, but the hilt, by comparison, is massive, offers a lot more protection, and the blade is broader with a lot more mass in it. So now this sword, if you want to talk about a slow and cumbersome sword, that's what this is. But ultimately, the heavy cavalrymen were selected from the tallest and the strongest. So they were usually around 6 foot tall or more, which for the time is a lot. Now I'm 5'7" and I can handle a heavy cavalry sword perfectly well. Even this monster I can actually wield. It's slow. I could use it, but boy, is it a handful. So there are some heavy cavalry swords that of the 1796 type that are absolutely brutish. Now, how good is this as a weapon? Well, as an actual fencing weapon, if you like, against one swordsman against another swordsman, it's slow and it's cumbersome. As in terms of protection and striking power, it's inevitably exceptional. So you have to judge that by yourself, but that's an interesting example. So to wrap up, what do I think and what do the historical sources think of the heavy cavalry sword? Well, most of the criticism is actually from modern sources. There are accounts of the time criticizing it for its length, in short or too long, and its thrusting ability and things like that. But mostly at the time, it was absolutely loved and respected. So, and it was used to great effect at battles like Waterloo. So how good was it? Well, actually, as a British cavalry sword that's designed for a heavy cavalryman, which is mostly going to be cutting, and did get improvements to the points to thrust better, actually, pretty good sword. So if you want to level any criticisms at it, well, they need to be leveled more at the approach that's being taken to the design, because it's designed to be a good length, mostly cutting sword with good hand protection. And if that's what you want out of a sword, this does it really, really well. So, is it a good or a bad sword? Ultimately, it's a pretty decent sword, and for the job it was intended for, really quite good. And it's also worth mentioning at this point that if I had to use it on foot, so I don't have much experience, inevitably, of cavalry combat, done my share of riding over the years here and there, but I don't practice cavalry combat. If I had to use a sword on foot, would I choose the heavy cavalry sword or the light cavalry sword? I would choose the heavy, because it has a bit of extra reach. The balance is slightly closer to the hand, so usually around 14 or 15 centimeters, something like that, whereas the light calves can be 19, 20 centimeter balances, so it's a bit more agile, it has more hand protection, has a little bit of extra reach. I would choose this over the light calf on foot. Which brings us to Richard Sharpe. So the fictional character of Richard Sharpe, written by Bernard Cornwell in his books and then put into the movies with Sean Bean, he uses a heavy cavalry trooper sword, exactly this, which is odd, to say the least, because, well, one, it's a cavalry sword, and two, it's a trooper's sword. So Richard Sharpe is neither of those things. He is a rifleman and an officer. Now, why was it written in? Well, it was written in for effect, because usually when you read accounts of officers who want a kind of a more brutish sword, which the officer that gave Sharpe the sword wanted something that would, you know, strike fear into the hearts of the enemy. If a rifleman wanted to do that, the chances are they would just get a light cavalry saber, because by regulation, the rifle officers used a small version of this, just a, literally a downsized, usually slightly more curved, but based on this and slightly smaller. So if a rifleman wanted something beastly, they'd probably just get an officer's light cav, because it would still look roughly regulation to their regulation standards, but it would be brutish in power. So the likelihood is that if an officer like Richard Sharpe wanted a brutish sword, it probably would have been a light cavalry saber. But fundamentally, I understand why they didn't do that, or Bernard Cornwell didn't do that, because it's really hard from the perspective of somebody who's not really into the research and knowledge of these swords to really see a difference between this and the infantry swords that are like it, because they look basically the same. And it's only when you get them in the hands that they feel so very different. Whereas by giving him the heavy cavalry sword, it was so obvious for all to see that he has this big brutish sword. Is it at all likely that an officer like Sharpe would have had a heavy cavalry sword, or a trooper's heavy cavalry especially? No. It's very unlikely. So they did often buy cavalry swords and foreign-made swords and stuff like that that were a bit more brutish, but they were usually sabers. So anyway, that is the British heavy cavalry trooper's sword, and the officer's versions I mentioned as well. How good are they? They actually are really good. They're a good fighting sword because they're not as slow as people think. They're actually fairly nimble and agile for what they are as a heavy cutting sword. And they have great hand protection, they move well, and they're quite durable. So actually, I really quite like them, and I think they are well suited to the job. I hope you've enjoyed the video, and please do subscribe if you haven't already. Thanks for watching.